Can I put in a request, make one copy with 14?
Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome you to our lecture hall where we have our regularly scheduled board meeting. Thank you for your attendance. A regular school board meeting of the Board of Trustees of the Pharr-San Juan-Alamo Independent School District is being held on Monday, today, March 25th, 2024, beginning at 6 o'clock. PSJA Early College High School Lecture Hall, 805 West Ridge Road, San Juan, Texas, 78589. This time, I'm going to go ahead and go to item two, which is the Pledge of Allegiance and Invocation. And we'll ask Ms. Diana Serna to lead us in the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Ms. Serna. And the invocation, Ms. Castillo, will you honor us with that?
Yes. Heavenly Father, here we come again, once again this afternoon. We give you thanks for your goodness, for your mercy, but first and foremost, for your unconditional love. Tonight, in a very special way, I ask you blessings upon our students. Give them the desire for learning. Keep them away from temptations that interrupt their focus on the learning. We ask you blessings for our teaching staff. Continue to give them the passion, the patience, the tolerance, and a serving heart for those students that they teach every single day. We ask that you bless our administration with a discerning and wise mind. And finally, we ask blessings upon us, the school board. Give us your wisdom, your guidance. Give us the understanding to make the right decisions for our staff, for our students, and for our community. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Mrs. Castillo. At this time, we have recognitions, Dr. Elias.
Yes, Mr. President, we have under 3A swimming and diving program, and this will be presented by Mr. Orlando Garcia, Director for Athletics.
Mr. President, Dr. Elias, and members of the board, we'd like to thank you for giving us this opportunity to recognize our student athletes. Today we're going to be recognizing some swimmers, divers, and wrestlers. All these are individual sports. These are into young men and young women that put a lot of time in the water or in the mats. And it's when you talk about individual sports, it's what they individually want to get out of each sport, how much time they want to get better than everybody else. And this is where I think the athletes separate themselves. It's not a team sport. It's about how much they want to get in this, in the mental preparation, and get ready for the sport. We're going to start off with recognizing the PSJ Lady Bears District Swimming and Diving Team. Can they please join me? Put the trophy in the middle. Let's throw off the trophy. Congratulations to the PSJ High Lady Bear Swim Team on winning the 31-6A Swimming and Diving District Championships. This is their seventh straight district championship for the Lady Bears. We had 12 Lady Bears qualify for the Region 8, 6A Swimming and Diving Championships. When I call out your name, ladies, please raise your hand. Sophomore, Regina Bocanegra. Sophomore, Bridget Cardenas. Freshman, Anna Elizondo. Freshman, Ava Garza. Senior, Caitlin Guzman. Junior, Carla Itubriates. Senior, team captain, Abigail Martinez. Sophomore, Leah Munoz. Sophomore, Paloma Sosa. Junior, team captain, Sofia Trevino. Freshman, Eximia Valdez. Sophomore, Sofia Vasquez. Sophomore, Madeline Wolny. Now I'm going to cover the individual district champions. Lady Bears individual district champions. I'm going to start off with sophomore Madeline Wolny. Madeline's sophomore swimming season was truly remarkable. Not only did she break all PSJA ISD district and Bear school records, but she also made history as the first Lady Bear swimmer to qualify for the state championship meet. Her outstanding performance earned her the title of Region 8 6A Swimmer of the Meet, where she won two individual events in record fashion and set new Laredo pool records. Additionally, Madeline was nominated as 31 6A Swimmer of the Meet and emerged as a district champion in all four events, the 50 freestyle, 100 freestyle, 200 freestyle relay, and 400 meter freestyle. Truly an exceptional season for Madeline. Sophomore Regina Bocanegra, district champion in the 200 medley relay, 100 yard butterfly, 100 yard backstroke, and 200 freestyle relay. District champion, sophomore Paloma Sosa, district champion in the 200 medley relay, 200 yard individual medley, 100 yard breaststroke, and 200 freestyle relay. Junior Sofia Trevino, district champion in a 200 freestyle, 200 freestyle relay, and 400 freestyle relay. Senior Abigail Martinez, district champion, 200 freestyle relay, and 400 freestyle relay. Senior Caitlin Guzman, she was a district champion in 200 meter relay and 400 freestyle relay. Their head coach is Pedro Saavedra, and assistant coach Irma Garcia, and aquatics director, John Landero. Congratulations. Thank you.
Congratulations, Doc.
Thank you, sir, for all that you do.
Continuing with swimming, if I could have the PSJ Bears boys swim team, please join me. Congratulations to the PSJA High Bears Boys Swim Team on winning the 31-6A Swimming and Diving Championship. This is a third straight year, a third straight district championship for the Bears. We're going to recognize the team for the district championship. When I call out your name, please raise your hand. Junior Frank Amaro. Junior Kai Arenas. Junior David Cantu. Junior Regino Cantu. Sophomore Giancarlo Cardenas. Sophomore Mario Carrillo. Junior Uziel Garcia. Senior team captain Isaac Garza. Freshman Gabriel Gomez. Senior Ryan Gomez. Freshman Zeke Gonzalez. Sophomore Christopher Gonzalez. Senior Christopher Gonzalez, correction. Sophomore Christopher Hernandez. Sophomore Matthew Mayasi. Senior team captain Arturo Razo. Freshman Isaac Tamez. Junior Jaden Tijerina. Freshman Kevin Tovar. Freshman Santiago Vargas. That's your district championship team. Now we're gonna introduce the individual district champions. Senior Ryan Gomez, district champion in the 200 individual medley and 100 yard breaststroke. Sophomore Kevin Tovar, district champion in the 200 yard freestyle. Junior Jai Arenas, district champion 100 yard butterfly, 200 yard freestyle. Relay. Sophomore Giancarlo Cardenas, district champion in the 500 yard freestyle. Junior David Cantu, district champion 100 yard backstroke. Junior Regino Cantu, district champion 200 yard freestyle relay. Senior Arturo Razo, district champion 200 freestyle relay. Head coach Pedro Taverda and assistant coach Irma Garcia. Congratulations.
Congratulations again. Great job, guys. Keep it up. Keep it up, guys. Good job. Keep it up. Great job, guys.
Thank you.
Way to go. Good job. Keep it up. Congratulations. Great job. Keep it up.
Continuing with swimming, if I could have PSJA Memorial Swimming and Diving Nathan Cano and his coaching staff, please come stand with me. Congratulations to PSJA Memorial freshman Nathan Cano on winning the 31-5A District Championship and the Region 4 Diving Championship. Mm-hmm. Nathan advanced to the 5A UIL State Diving Championship at the Lee and Joel Jamel Texas Swimming Center at the University of Texas at Austin, where he competed with the best divers in the state of Texas. PSJA Memorial Nathan Cano ranked 17 in the state of Texas, along with being one of the top 5A freshmen in the state of Texas. He is coached by dive coach Leslie Ortiz and head swim coach Ben Waddell and aquatics director Jonathan Landero. Congratulations.
Okay, and at this time, we're going to go ahead and entertain comments from the board in regards to our swim teams and participants, and then we'll go into the wrestling ceremonies. I'll start with my colleague, Jesse Vela.
Thank you, Mr. President. First of all, you know, PSJA is known for a lot of things, but if you keep this up, you're going to be a powerhouse at the state level. In fact, you're already making a name for yourselves, all of you that participate in swimming and diving and all the other activities. This is really, really commendable, and it's a tribute to you, your parents, your coaches, your teachers, all of the individuals that encourage you on a day-to-day basis. All the people that you see, you talk to, and they influence you, and you just become better and better and better. I notice many of you are freshmen and sophomores, and that's fantastic. So that means that, let me see, it's seven in a row, count on 8, 9, 10 for sure?
Definitely.
It's no pressure, but keep up the great work. Just keep up the great work. You have excellent facilities and excellent coaches and teachers who guide you and encourage you to be the best you can be. And that's all we can ask. You're a tribute to the district. You give the district more of a presence all over the state of Texas. And you can swim anywhere. So congratulations also. Thank you, parents. Thank you for everything that you do for your sons and your daughters, and to encourage them, to keep them going forward always. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Vela. Ms. Serna.
Again, we're proud of you, and it's so true what you say, Mr. Vela, that, you know, we are well known across the state for so many different things, and you keep doing it, and you keep doing it. I mean, 7 times in a row is something. It's great. And I commend you. I love to swim, but I always did it for just fun, never for competition. And then we had the Paralympic pool, and to me back then, it seemed like the diving board was too far up in the sky. So I never did dive from it. All I could do was jump. So I congratulate you for all that you do. And I know it's hard work. And it's admirable. It really is. It takes a lot. We admire it. And we're proud of you. Please know. And keep doing what you're doing. And go as Bears and Wolverines that succeeded in this area. Keep doing it. Thank you, guys. God bless you.
Thank you, Mrs. Sedna. I'll go ahead and allow Mrs. Castillo now.
To echo my colleagues' comments, you all are just incredible young kids, and you've got your whole life ahead of you. So imagine what you're going to do. So congratulations again. We always talk about, excuse me, integration of curriculum, science, social studies, literacy, math. Well, you're doing it all. You're doing it all. It takes a team of three, the educators, the parents, and you. But at the end of the day, it's you. You're the ones that are making those good choices. So again, I commend you, I congratulate you, and let's continue. Denle gas, como se dice, dale gas. Keep it up, guys. You can do it. Can you imagine? Where do you see yourselves 10 years from now? Congratulations.
Thank you, Mrs. Castillo. Obviously, I just want to echo everything that's already been said, but I want to say that I'm proud of the fact that the district has the finest facilities around, and it's paying off now in our students reaping the rewards of having those facilities. But since we're talking about swimming, congratulations. It's a sport that a lot of people really don't know how strenuous it is. It's something that you need to know, really, and you should encourage all your siblings and friends to make that jump into swimming, whether it's recreational or through academics or whatever you want to call it. But you never know. It's something that's going to be good for your body. It gives you that energy going forward as you get older. It tones your body. You never know when you're going to be asked to help somebody in need because you see somebody in a bad situation in the water. But swimming is something that's so valuable, and I want to commend each and every one of you, our ladies and our men, for doing what you're doing. But more than anything, I want to congratulate you and commend you for bringing notoriety to PSJA. Like the my colleagues have said, all three of them, we excel at everything, and swimming is just one of those areas where we excel a lot at. So congratulations. Keep up the good work. Parents, keep on trucking. Keep on after your kids, and continue to encourage them. And God bless each and every one of you. Dr. Elias?
Yes, Mr. President, we have under 3B wrestling program, and again, this will be presented by Orlando Garcia, athletic director.
If I could have PSJA North Wrestling head coach and PSJA North wrestler Graciela Juarez, please join me. PSJA North High School, congratulations to Graciela Juarez. She's a junior. She's a 16-5A district champion in her weight class. Weight class is? 130. The 138 weight class. She advanced to her third UIL state tournament, where she ended her season with a 34-4 record, with 30 wins coming by the way of pinfall. And she was also recognized. She was also recognized by the National Coaches Association as a high school All-American.
Oh, wow. Congratulations.
That's amazing, sir. Congratulations.
Congratulations.
Thank you for all that you've done. She's your pride and joy. There you go. Slide this, this way.
If I could have the PSJ Bears boys wrestling team and their coaching staff, please join me. Congratulations to the PSJ High School boys wrestling team on winning the 16-6A team dual district championship and the district 16-6A wrestling tournament championship. If I call you out your name, please raise your hand. At the 106-pound class, sophomore Rolando Parra. The 113-pound senior Tristan Corona. 120-pound senior Romeo Ramos. 126-pound junior Ricardo Fernandez. 132-pound junior Luis Garza. 138-pound junior Troy Torres. 144-pound senior Aaron Salinas. 150-pound junior Jorge Alaniz, George Alaniz. 157-pound Valdemar Cantu, junior. 165-pound junior Cody Barrios. 175-pound senior Jose Carrion. 190-pound sophomore Marco Minus. 215-pound junior Joshua Castillo. 285-pound sophomore Jonathan Silva. Next, I will introduce the individual district champions. In the 126-pound category, junior champion Ricardo Fernandez. Individual district champion, 144-pound senior Aaron Salinas. Individual district champion, 215-pound champion Joshua Castillo, junior. Individual district champion, 165-pound Kayla Figueroa, sophomore. Congratulations. And head coach, Javier Rendon.
Great job, guys. Once again, congratulations, guys. This time, I'll entertain comments from the board. So I'll start this time with the Honorable Mrs. Yolanda Castillo.
I just want to say that as I'm watching, as I'm looking from here, I feel joy to just to see the parents smile. A little while ago, a parent was here and she said, I'm the mother. And you know what? That's amazing. I'm a mother too, and I remember when my kids were being recognized. It's a really good feeling inside. So you all are doing amazing things. Remember, it all starts in the home. So congratulations, keep it up. And again, you're doing amazing. Can you imagine how you're gonna do 5 years from now, 10 years from now? You'll probably be sitting here where we're sitting, and that's not a bad thing. So again, congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you. I'll go ahead and go with me and then just proceed this. And I'll just say a few words because I know absolutely nothing about wrestling. I knew a little bit about swimming, wrestling. I can tell you that I would probably fail at it. But I want to commend you guys because, again, that's got to be such a strenuous sport. But, again, it's something that's going to help you in life. If it for anything, just kind of defend yourself against something that might happen. But I want to commend you for the training you go through, having to get up early, I'm assuming, to go practice. But it's just quite an achievement. It's just one of those achievements that PSJA is proud of, and we're certainly proud of each and every one of you. Like I said, I don't know that much about wrestling. Maybe my colleague in a little while might know a little bit more, Jesse Vela, but you know, we'll hear from him. Ms. Edna.
I know a little bit more.
Okay.
All I know is that they count 1, 2, 3, and somebody wins. That is a tough sport. I see them just, you know, tumbling around and holding on, and it's just, that's really strenuous. I look at it and I think, oh my gosh, you really have to have so much training for that, and then to monitor your weight, and it's just a lot that goes into it. And again, it, like you said, Ms. Castillo, it all begins at home. And parents, you know, you have reason to be so, so very proud. Congratulations to you as well. God bless you guys.
Mr. Vela.
Hey, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Again, congratulations. And it's true, everything about the fact that wrestling is one of the toughest sports to participate in. It takes a lot of physical ability and a lot of technique. And it's not easy to do all those maneuvers and all those particular things and how it scored and those sorts of things. But I commend you, all of you that participate in wrestling. As I said, it takes a lot of hard work. You have to be incredibly, incredibly physical and aggressive. And you do need to learn a lot of good technique to beat your opponent. I've seen a lot of wrestling, and it's rough. It's rough. You know, when you get out of a match and your body hurts. You got bruises where you didn't think you had muscles. But again, congratulations for everything that you do. I congratulate, where's Ms. Juarez? Ms. Juarez, thank you for being a partner to your daughter. And know you well and your family. But the parents are also very, very important. Because when you're hurting and your body's hurting, they need some healing. They need some love, some tender, loving care. So look out for them again. Keep working with them. I appreciate the fact that you participate. You're equally as important as all the students that are wrestling, that are helping make the district as strong as it is. So congratulations again to all of you. Keep up the great work. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Vela. Dr. Elias.
Yes, Mr. President. The next items is UIL for the Fine Arts, and this will be presented by Director Mr. John Taylor.
Mm-hmm. Mr. President, Dr. Elias, members of the board, thank you for giving the Fine Arts Department this opportunity to recognize the outstanding achievements of our fine arts students. Thank you also for your continued support of our fine arts programs. Tonight, we are recognizing mariachis who earned awards at the UIL State Mariachi Contest. This year, all four PSJA ISD mariachis earned first division ratings at the UIL Region Mariachi Contest and qualified to compete at the state competition, which was held February 22nd through 24th at Seguin High School. Of the 89 mariachis competing at state, only 27 earned the highest honor, a UIL State First Division trophy. Only 32 mariachis had students who earned the Outstanding Performer Medal. Nicolas Lopez from PSJ High earned the Outstanding Performer Medal for his violin playing. You may remember that Nicholas is also an All-State Mariachi member, our first. His directors are Head Director Adriana Olivan and Assistant Directors Albert Garcia and Steve Gutierrez. Congratulations, Nick. Sophia Acosta from PSJ North earned the Outstanding Performer Medal for her singing. Her directors are Head Director Mary Echeverria and Assistant Directors Dolores Bartolo and Michael Barrera. Congratulations, Sophia.
They should have brought their guitars.
Just raise your hand when I call your name. Please raise your hand when I call your name.
You don't have your instruments in the car, do you? No, no, I'm just joking.
I was going to sing if you... The PSJ Early College High School Mariachi Maravilla de San Juan earned a first division trophy for the fourth year in a row. Members are Valdemar Cantu, Daniel Chavez, Dante Chavez, Trinity Flores, Jake Garcia, Clarissa Garza, Jordan Gonzalez, Nicolas Lopez, Enoch Martinez, Marvelli Mesa, Deborah Pena, Emiliana Requena, Sheridan Reyes, Seticia Rodriguez, Aileen Cifuentes, Princess Torres, Kevin Torres, and Brianna Villegas. Directors are Head Director Adriana Olivan and Assistant Directors Albert Garcia and Steve Gutierrez. Congratulations, PSJ Early College High School Mariachi Maravilla de San Juan.
That's a pretty name to have a mariachi. Great job. Congratulations. Congratulations. Great job. Congratulations. You're all guys are awesome. Awesome again. Congratulations to all of you guys. Dr. Elias.
He's going to continue with the film.
Okay.
Film students. Theater students from across the state compete in UIL film competition. Film entries advanced through several rounds, finally advancing to the State Film Festival, which was held at the University of Texas, Austin, LBJ Auditorium on February 28. Tonight, we are recognizing PSJA North Theater students who placed at the UIL State Film Festival. PSJA North's film, Escaping Reality, received the sixth place state plaque for 5A digital animation. Filmmakers are Renee Badillo, Christian Chavez, Aiden Gomez, Mia Mendoza, Ailema Reyes, Naomi Salceda, and Matthew Suarez. Congratulations, UIL State sixth place digital animation winners. North's film Dreams Unboxed came in third place in 5A documentary, earning a third place state plaque as well as individual state bronze medals for each participant. Students are Renee Badillo, Aiden Gomez, Camila Gonzalez, and Isabella Tagle. Congratulations, UIL State third place documentary winners. PSJA North's film The Palm Awards came in second place in 5A documentary, earning a second place state plaque as well as individual state silver medals. Filmmakers are Jace Arredondo, Renee Badillo, Ashley Bocanegra, Aiden Gomez, Paola Salazar, and Sofia Salazar. Congratulations, UIL State second place documentary winners. PSJA North Theater Directors are Head Director Brian Hano and Assistant Directors Jackie Cepeda and Tommy Green. Congratulations, PSJA North Theater UIL State Film Festival Award winners.
Dr. Elias.
Yes, Mr. President, we have a presentation for Communications and Public Relations Department staff as they earned a state award. This will be presented by Claudia Limas, PR.
I could please have members of our Communications Department come down and join me, even those in the back in the video room. Good evening, Mr. President, Dr. Elias, and members of the board. We are incredibly honored and proud to share that our communications team was recently awarded numerous state awards from the Texas School Public Relations Association for outstanding work in school communications. The awards were announced during TSPRA's annual Star Awards ceremony held in February in Sugar Land, Texas recently. Of thousands of productions received from across the state, from numerous public school districts, the following awards, state awards were earned by our department. Crystal Certificate of Merit for Video Portfolio, which honors high quality productions, demonstrating research, planning, production for a variety of video works, such as news packages, features, marketing, and live events. This is a highly competitive category, and the video portfolio included work produced by all of our PSJA ISD video team members. It's a group effort. We also earned a Best of Category medal and Gold Award in the video category for our PSJA ISD Students Incorporate Sustainability video spot produced by videographer Edgar Hernandez. Gold awards earned in the video category are also as follows. For a video and events category, for the Don't Drink and Drive Shattered Dreams PSA produced by videographer Matthew Cortez. Another gold. News package, PSJA Wolverines football player will cheer in college, produced by reporter Mauricio Razo. Video feature, 2023 State Mariachi Festival video by Edgar Hernandez. Promotional video of the PSJA Metro Hubs produced by Matthew Cortez. And marketing video of the PSJA Building Blocks Academy produced by Edgar Hernandez. In the print category, we also came home with numerous awards. a gold award in the image identity package for all the work of the PSJ academies. This was awarded to multimedia coordinator Darlene Gracia. A silver star for posters. This was for the Inspiring the Future movie poster placed at the Pharr Cinemark Theater last year. Also Darlene Gracia. And then in bronze, but the staff member is not present, we received a bronze in the flyer category for the Building Blocks Academy ad by Lorelei Lopez. And then in the logo category for the sustainability emblem as well, also by Ms. Lorelei Lopez. Additionally, video production lead Marco Vasquez was presented with the Professional Achievement Award, which honors individuals who have exhibited a creative, dedicated, and professional approach to school communications. Mr. Vasquez has dedicated over 25 years serving our PSJ family. I want to congratulate our entire team. Earning these awards and recognitions show the high quality work and storytelling happening every day by our communications department. And we want to thank all members of our team, even those not present, even our clerk and our secretary, because there's a lot of the work that we do that we cannot make happen without everybody coming together and working as a team. On behalf of our team, we would also like to thank our superintendent, Dr. Alejandro Elias, for his vision and ongoing support and trusting us to tell these stories, giving us that creative freedom that a lot of districts don't, you know, have for their teams. And so we really, really appreciate that. And also to our school board of trustees for also their support and their vision. Our team is humbled and honored for the opportunity to get to communicate all the wonderful news and stories happening every day at PSJA ISD, and we thank everyone who reaches out and lets us know what's happening, because we take a lot of pride in sharing that. So congratulations to our team, and thank you again on our behalf.
Mark, congratulations. Thank you, Claudia. At this time, I'm going to go ahead I'll have the board comment on any one of the three areas that we just were privileged to see here. So I'll start with Mr. Jesse Vela.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. First of all, mariachi group, our film group, all our fine artists. I enjoy listening to mariachi music, and I have seen some outstanding performances, outstanding students, and you showed what you can do, and you were rewarded for that, for all your hard work, and I appreciate that. Continue working hard. Always get better at what you do. Congratulations. I've always known that we have an outstanding fine arts program in all areas, whether it's mariachi, music, art, theater, drama, you name it, we excel. And we're usually wind up at the top. And people wind up chasing you to get better. So congratulations to all of you for the great work that you do. Congratulations to all the teachers, those that support you, your parents, everybody that has anything to do with influencing you as you see them daily. So congratulations, congratulations to the Public Relations Department. What can I say? I mean, I've been here, this is my 12th year, and we have an outstanding communications department, outstanding. The things that I see, and you know, we get better. I've seen some great things happening in the communications department as well. So keep up the great work, guys. I think I know I use you and abuse you a lot. I have done that in the past, but thank you so much for everything that you do to make us look good. And by us, I mean the school district. Everybody wins. Everybody. Congratulations and on your awards. Well deserved. Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Trustee Sedna.
We're just shining all over the place, you know, be it academic, be it sports, we're just there, and they know who we are. And it's you, all these students like you that have made us so proud and have just put us on the map. Ms. Sophia, with her, you know, everybody, Nicholas Lopez, Mrs. Lopez, I feel like I know him because I've seen him so often here. he's amazing. But all of you are amazing, and I saw Mr. Vadillo here in front just raise his hand, I don't know how many times, so he participates a lot. You know, it's just amazing all that you do, and what really, really has grabbed me tonight is that we have so much talent, and so many of you that have excelled in your specific area, and then on top of all that, we have our adult crew back there, the media staff that has also put us on the map and keeps us shining, puts out everything that you all do. So it's just a big deal that it's students and staff that have done something tonight. And I just want to applaud all of you for all the talent that you have displayed and all the pride that you bring to PSJA. Thank you so much.
I'm just going across the aisle here, but again, everything that's already been said, I can repeat. And I must say that, first of all, congratulations to all the parents. It's a lot of hard work for the students because they have a passion, they have a vision, they have a goal that they want to reach, but it's you parents that are there day in and day out for them. I also want to commend all of the teachers, the support staff, especially the sponsors, who transcend their knowledge and pass it down to their students and make sure that that they excel. And this goes for all the mariachis. And I've already said, and Jesse, I think, I don't know, Jesse, if you've been to a conference where, or my other colleagues, where it's such a pride to have a conference open in the morning for the first time, whether it be in Dallas or San Antonio or Houston, and it's mariachi band from so-and-so. Well, we'd like for you guys, Mr. Taylor, see if you can't write letters and tell them that our mariachis are ready to open any conference. Okay? So we would like to see that happen. But we're awfully proud of that. And for the rest of the crew here, for our winners in all the other awards and the Festival Awards, it takes a lot of creation, a lot of dedication, a lot of commitment. So you guys are doing an awesome job. Just got to keep up the good work because it's going to follow you when you get out of high school. It's going to follow you and it's going to be part of your resume. So use that to reach other chapters in your life. Remember that. And for Claudia and your team, where's Claudia? Claudia, I've got to commend you because, and I'll say this for the mariachis also, there is never an event that we're not going to hold that we don't call on the spur of the moment, and then you're there. The professionalism, the timeliness, the commitment to make things happen, and you're always there. You never say no, because then you'd have to explain to him why you said no. But thank you for that commitment. I think you all are doing an awesome job highlighting and broadcasting what the good things are at PSJA, so continue the good work. Thank you.
As I hear of your success and your accomplishments, I can't think of all the attributes, the character ed that you are acquiring. Think about how reflective you have to be. Think about how many times you've taken risks, how many times you have had to come to a consensus, being open-minded. How many times have you inquired about different things? And all that are skills that you will be needing in life. So I commend you for already practicing all these attributes that are needed in life. And if you acquire all that is at this young age, all these characteristics and attributes, you're gonna do well in life. So congratulations. I will end by saying this. No sé si ustedes han escuchado que la música es comida para el alma. The music you have, music is food for the soul. But you know what? I'm gonna say all that you do is food for the soul, because that inspires you to continue. And you know, you're recognized. I know when I'm recognized, I wanna do better. So I'm hoping that we're doing that tonight. Congratulating you, applauding your efforts, and keep up the good work. Keep on doing what you love. And that's going to give you a lot of good times in life. And you're gonna grow and become incredibly human beings. So keep up the good work. Congratulations again to all your teachers, your mentors, your parents, your grandparents, everybody, all the PSJA village. So congratulations, and let's carry on to be the best that we can be. Thank you.
At this time, I'll entertain, or I'll ask if we had any public comment requests. No public comments. So that being said, what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna go ahead and move executive session up in the agenda. We're gonna go into executive session at this time. It's not gonna be long. It's not gonna be long, so we should be out shortly, and then we'll continue with the rest of the meeting.
You can dismiss the...
Yes, all our students, you're gonna go do your homework. Thank you for being here. Thank you for being here. Congratulations.
Nomás eso, not the rest?
And, yeah.
Not the rest?
Yeah, the employment. Personnel matters the most.
Personnel matters and approval of... Okay. At this time, under Government Code 551.071 through 551.084, we will be going into executive session in accordance with the Texas Open Meetings Act. Items to be discussed are personnel matters and approval of superintendent's evaluation and contract. Thank you. We're now back from executive session, and the time is 7:45. Dr. Elias.
Yes, Mr. President, we have under executive session, we have the employment of instructional professional personnel.
And his and recommendation, sir?
We have a recommendation for an assistant principal for PSJA Early Start.
Make a motion, Mr. Chairman. Recommend Michelle Garcia. As discussed in executive session.
I have a motion. Do I have a second?
I second.
And a second. All those in favor? Raise your right hand. Motion carries.
Yes, Mr. President, for the PSJA Early Start Assistant Principal, it's Michelle Garcia. The next one is Grants Department. We have a grant writer for LASSO coordinator.
I'll entertain a motion for the grant writer position.
What's your recommendation?
He's going to make it.
Tanya. Okay, I'd like to move that we accept Tanya Reyes as in that position.
I'll entertain a second.
Second.
Motion's been made with a second. All those in favor, raise your right hand. Motion carries. Item C, Doctor.
Yes, we're still with the instructional professional personnel. We have grants department, grant manager.
I'll entertain a motion for the grant manager.
So moved, Mr. President. Chloe Tapia.
Okay. I'm sorry, I recognize you.
Okay. I move to recommend Chloe Tapia Garcia as discussed in executive session.
Second.
Been a motion made and a second that Chloe Garcia is the nomination and acceptance. All those in favor, raise your right hand.
Aye.
Motion carries. Thank you. Dr. Elias.
Mr. Board President. If I may just clear up the record, those recommendations are from the superintendent and the board just approved those recommendations from the superintendent.
Okay. As directed by council.
To approve the contract.
Yes.
I was just clarifying the actions you guys just took.
Okay.
Right. But now I'm going to entertain a motion to.
I would like to move that we accept the contract for Dr. Alejandro Elias as was discussed in executive session.
I'll entertain a second. Second made by Ms. Castillo. We have a motion and a second for the contract. All those in favor, raise your right hand. Motion carries. Congratulations, Dr. Elias.
And one more action, Mr. Board President, on that item. If we could, if the board could approve the evaluation as well, just to make it official.
Can make an amendment to that?
That's fine. You already approved the contract, but let's just, if the board could have a motion
to. Just note that we're adding an amendment to that, that we're accepting with the contract the evaluation.
We could just get a motion to approve the evaluation
okay.
as discussed.
I move to approve the evaluation.
Motion made.
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Vela. All those in favor, raise your right hand. Motion carries. Thank you. Okay. Dr. Elias.
Yes.
Oh, we have something else on two employees.
Mr. Board President, members of the board, and Dr. Elias, on item C and D, they're the two, they're related items. If the board could please, the advice of counsel is that the board approve those two items as discussed in closed session. Item C and D.
Motion.
Second.
Motion by Mr. Vela, seconded by Ms. Sedna, that we approve as discussed in executive session. Item C, all those in favor, raise your right hand.
And
motion carries. Thank you.
And then for item E, Mr. Board President, members of the board, discussion and possible action to terminate the employee of contract of RVC. The advice of counsel that the board approve this item as well.
As indicated by counsel, authority to the superintendent to act on this non-Chapter 21 employment contract.
No, this one's on item E, sir. This is just the termination.
Termination.
So move.
Second.
Motion made by Ms. Sedna, second by Mr. Vela. All those in favor, raise your right hand. Motion carries. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, Mr. President, under presentation, we also have a presentation for District Employee Health Clinic, and this will be presented by our Director for Health, Ms. Zulema Flores.
Welcome, Zulema.
Thank you. Good evening, Mr. President Villegas, Dr. Elias, members of the board.
I apologize, Zulema Solis.
Zulema Solis, yes. I don't know what you said, sir, but that's okay. Okay, so we are very fortunate in our school district and for our employees as well to have an employee clinic. We've had one since 2004, actually. So for 20 years, our employees have had an opportunity of having a clinic available to them exclusively because the clinic is not open to the public, but is open to them and their families that are insured by our school district insurance. So they're seen there for acute and chronic services as well. Next slide. Oh, we can move here. Okay, so the PSJA, I'm here seeking approval to terminate the HealthSmart primary care clinic agreement that we currently have. So HealthSmart has notified PSJA ISD of its intention to terminate services to PSJA ISD on May 31st of 2024. So due to the acquisition of HealthSmart primary care clinics by United Healthcare in 2023, HealthSmart primary care clinics will no longer support employee-sponsored clinics. So as a result, all clinic services currently being offered to PSJA by HealthSmart primary care clinic will terminate at the close of business May 31st, 2024. So good news is where I am also here seeking approval to establish a PSJA ISD employee clinic as of June 1st, 2024. And so what are some of the benefits of us as a school district, PSJA, managing our own employee clinic? Well, that we can closely monitor the clinic, right, by our school district. There will be considerable cost savings, financial transparency, access to the clinical data, an increase in quality and efficiency of patient care, and a more responsive employee clinic, so meeting our individual staff needs, and a reduction of cost of insurance claims and workers' compensation claims. So right now and going forward, you know, we would be paying a monthly fee for having the clinic. Our employees are seen at the doctor's office and they could be seen 12 different times by a private physician and have 12 different claims billed to our school district. If they utilize our clinic, it doesn't matter if they're seen there 12 different times, it's still a set cost. Right, so this would reduce the cost for us. The same with workers' compensation. So if we're able to treat those patients in-house, that would reduce the cost on our insurance as well that we pay out. So the cost saving that we're looking at, that was one way that we'll be saving, but also the approximate annual cost of the PSJA HealthSmart Employee Clinic is $1,333,000 per year that we pay. So we're estimating that there'll be, if we manage the clinic ourselves and we won't have that third party, we're seeing a savings of about $700,000 a year if we manage the clinic ourselves. So what are the benefits to the employees? So we hope, of course, that we have improved employee health, right? That's always our goal. We want them to have the best health possible, reduce the absences, prompt treatment, increased screening and early detection, increased productivity, greater employee satisfaction and retention, because not very many districts have an employee clinic. We're very, very fortunate here to have one. Increased preventive care, acute and chronic condition management. So they don't only see you for minor illnesses, but they also manage chronic conditions. And the cost savings. Our employees do not have to pay a copay for their visits, so they get to save on that. So for themselves and their families, right? So who receives these services? So all employees that are covered under our current Blue Cross Blue Shield services are eligible to be seen at the clinic, as well as their family members that they have covered under Blue Cross Blue Shield. So what are the types of services? Like I mentioned, chronic condition management. So hypertension, hyperlipidemia, a lot of these conditions, they can be managed there easily at the clinic. Acute illnesses, right? Respiratory illness, COVID cases, all of that can be managed. High blood pressure, cholesterol, allergies, upper respiratory infections, strains, sprains, urinary tract infections. Like I mentioned, workers' comp, claims, vaccinations, COVID-19 testing, annual exams and screenings, and of course, lab services, which our employees really utilize. And so who would we have this clinic staffed with? We would have a full-time medical doctor. We would have a full-time nurse practitioner, as well as a part-time nurse practitioner, a clinic manager, and four certified nurse assistants. One would serve as a reception of those four. So they could work both in the front and the back if needed. And out of those four nurse assistants, one of them is will also serve as a phlebotomist. And so what are our expectations for our physician and our nurse practitioners, the standards of care? So they shall meet or exceed the standards of care customary in the medical profession. They shall engage in continuous quality improvement practices to enhance the delivery of healthcare services. And the physician, nurse practitioners, and all employee clinic staff will follow the PSJA ISD care customer service standards. Excellence, service first, family always. Right, so we expect them to be courteous, attentive, responsive, and exceptional. And so we did come up with medical provider expectations that we will require every employee to sign. And so these do include some of the care, and I know they're too small to see, but basically, you know, being very professional and following that care. And Another big advantage to us having the clinic managed by PSJA is that we are really, really hoping that this clinic will be fully staffed. We had several issues with working with a third party. We started with the agreement during the COVID time, and so it was very hard for them to staff the clinic. And many times since then, they've had issues staffing the clinic. So because of that reason, they weren't able to see the number of patients that we wanted them to see. Right now, us owning the clinic, managing the clinic, we're going to be able to monitor that closely, ensure that the clinic is always staffed fully, right, and make sure that the hours of operation are maintained. So we want Monday through Thursday, 7 a.m. to 7:30 p.m., Friday, 8 a.m. to 5 p.m., and Saturday, 8 to 12. So, we're really hoping that if approved today, we can move forward and get a lot of patients seen at the clinic. And our expectation is to have them see at least, each provider see at least 25 patients, full-time provider see at least 25 patients a day. And so I'm open to questions, and that's the end of my presentation.
I have a question. Yes, Ms. Emma.
Have we had it open on Saturdays before?
Yes, we have. However, because of the staffing issue, there has been times where, you know, they don't have a provider or they haven't had the medical assistants, the CNAs, to be able to assist the doctors. And now if we are able to manage the clinic ourselves, you know, we're going to hire enough staff where we can help, you know. Yes, continue with those services on Saturday for sure.
Mr. President.
Yes.
Question. Right now, how many patients do you see on an average, on a daily basis?
So on an average, because of their lack of staff, they've been seeing approximately, they do see about 25 patients for lab a day, right? So that's the amount of patients that will come in and get lab work done. And that's also something that's probably not being monitored accurately. And if we are able to oversee it, you know, labs are done at certain times of the year, and I'm not sure if that's being done the correct way, but we can monitor that more closely. They also give me a count for the number of COVID testing that they do, and they give me a count of the number of actual patient encounters, right? They do telemedicine visits, and they do actual in-person. So I would say on an average, each provider is seeing anywhere from 10 to maybe 15 patients, but our expectation is for them to see at least 20 to 30 patients a day, which would be approximately 3 an hour.
Right, yeah.
So that is our expectation. However, they're not doing that, and that's been the reason, because it's not fully staffed.
Right, mm-hmm. But once we approve, if we approve, you foresee?
Yeah, so they, on the contract that we currently have, the agreement that we currently have, they didn't have the four CNAs that we're looking to hire, right? At most times, they had two. One would serve as a receptionist, the other one would serve as phlebotomist, and the CNA trying to get the patients into the rooms. So that was very difficult for them. And with having two providers and one person trying to do all of that, it was difficult for them. Mm-hmm. So I foresee us, you know, being able to get the patients in and get them seen and still continue to encourage telemedicine visits when it's appropriate, right? But also allow patients to come in and give appointments as needed.
Let me, I think Jesse was after Yolanda. You had some questions, Mr. Vela?
Yes. So your expectations are that you're probably more than double the services, the number of individuals
Absolutely.
You can serve so that, you know, some of them, you know, won't leave.
So they won't disappointed. Be turned away.
Right. They right. won't be turned away. And then that's been the ongoing complaint. Mm-hmm. Okay.
The accessibility of having it here within our district.
It's local and they don't have to go too far mm-hmm. to get seen and get good, you know, quality service.
Mm-hmm.
Expectation, any idea what the budget's going to look like? We're going to save $700,000.
Right, so we're estimating about $600,000 and maybe less, right? And okay. possibly with less claims being, if we're able to see more patients, that's less claims that we're going to have coming in because they'll be utilizing the clinic versus going to a private doctor.
Okay.
So there might be even a more substantial savings, right, from what I'm estimating. But okay. And I'm hoping for that. If we utilize it more, there'll be more savings.
We have the facility big enough to handle that many staff members?
Yes. Enough to where each provider will have enough rooms mm-hmm. to be able to have the patients there ready for them to see them. And they mm-hmm. also do telemedicine visits as well. Like okay. they'll do a phone consultation or they'll do a video consultation as well.
What about the medical equipment, the medical
so
related?
So all the equipment stays with us. So
everything will stay here?
Yes. So when we partnered with HealthSmart Primary Clinic, all mm-hmm. that cost we incurred. So all the equipment, okay. everything stays.
So you paid it up front?
Yes. Okay. So the only other cost to us would be the monthly cost of supplies that we're going to continue to utilize at the clinic, right? We'll continue to purchase those, as well as the electronic medical record program, paying for, like, medical waste, right? So those are, it's minimal costs that we're going to have to incur other than, you know, the salaries okay. of the employees.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, Ms. Sedna.
Yeah, I just have one question. I'm not going to say if we approve, I'm saying when we approve
okay,
tonight.
Okay, good.
How far in do you think you foresee it being fully staffed?
So we're hoping June 1st,
okay.
and to have it fully staffed June 1st. That's okay. our expectation. So if approved, we can move forward, you know, with interviews and getting those contracts okay. completed. And
okay. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
I like the challenge of having our own clinic because from what we can see, we're going to service more of our people.
Mm-hmm.
There's going to be more accessibility. Hopefully we're not going to be turning people away.
Exactly.
One of the questions that was asked prior to this, and I didn't know what to answer, but I did talk to Mr. Elias about it. And I think it can work out. Some of our staff have a conference period where mm-hmm. all they need is a simple blood work. If they can go in and out and get the blood work done during a conference period, come back.
Mm-hmm.
And not maybe have to take a half a day, like has been told to me, happens a lot of times.
Right.
We're saving in that area also. It's to go to the clinic, come back, and you don't have to go to a private doctor.
Right.
Plus the fact that we're going to have a standalone clinic that belongs to us, and we're saving $700,000.
I think we're going to be leading the way as an example to the rest of the state.
Well, and, you know, I'm so excited
about not very many districts
that.
Have this, so it's
so,
I love
again,
being first.
Can
I love
make
it
another
too.
Comment, Mr. President?
Yes, you may.
One of the comments I wanted to make is if we see that we're servicing a lot of our employees and we see the need, we're already looking that we could possibly open another facility further from the one that we have, maybe more centralized, where we could also service so from two different locations.
We have areas that you've been looking
yes.
at for.
Mm-hmm. And it's already, you know, buildings from within the district, so, yes.
There you go.
Sounds good.
Go on by your house.
not bad.
Yes. Well, that's yes. excellent.
If that is the case, sir, I move approval.
We're
at a presentation.
Oh, okay.
So it'll be part of the consent agenda.
Can you bring it
okay.
next time for approval?
yes.
It's good. It sounds good.
No, but you'll be approving it in consent
agenda.
Okay.
Oh,
okay.
Okay.
Okay. Well, thank you very
excellent
much. Thank you.
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 I think there was one more item, Dr. Elias, that was being requested that be pulled out for discussion, and the rest of it is all going to be consent. And, well, actually, we're going to go into consent item, but I think you're requesting to pull out...
Yes, Mr. President, we're looking in consent agenda to pull out 7B, and that one, we're just going to take it out, and we will bring it back in April because the substantial completion was not completed. So we have a few items that need to be completed, so we won't bring it back to the board till April.
So 7B, we're not going to go ahead and discuss tonight. We're just pulling it out of consent.
Yes, and there's another item, Ms. Serna.
It is...
The calendar?
Yes.
Yes, on the calendar. We're going to have that presentation?
Yes.
Okay.
We're going to have a presentation real quick on the calendar, and that'll take us to the end of the evening. So at this time, with what's being said, we'll go ahead and entertain a motion for to approve the rest of the consent items. If anybody has any questions, are they all right with that?
Minus 7B.
Huh?
Minus
7B and?
8A.
8A.
Okay.
I move to approve the consent items.
Motion been made.
Without the exception of
I seconded.
7B and 8A.
And seconded by Ms. Castillo. All those in favor, raise your right hand. Motion carries. Thank you. Okay, let's go to...
Yes, Mr. President, we go to Student Services 10A, and we will have the presentation on the academic calendar for 2024-2025 school year. And this will be presented by Dr. Noyola.
Good evening, Mr. President, Dr. Elias, and members of the board. Before I start the slides, I wanted to let you know that 3 years ago, our district applied for a grant. It is called the Additional Days School Year Planning and Execution Program Grant. And there were some requirements for that grant, and this is, we're already in the third year. And what are two of the major requirements? The first one is that we're supposed to have 180 school days for the students the entire year, starting in August all the way through June. So we have to have 180 school days. The second thing that we're supposed to have is 25 days of enrichment days. Enrichment days usually happen during the summer. We used to, in the olden days, I say three more, yep. Earlier than those 3 years that I'm talking about, we used to have only 12 days of summer school. But we, by this, with this grant, we have to have 25 school days. So I just wanted to give you some background because I know that some staff or faculty say, why do other school districts have, you know, more things in their calendar? Well, our calendar is limited. Another thing that limits us is what we know, Texas Education Code Section 25.0811, that says that we cannot start school earlier than the fourth Monday in August. Okay, so with those two things in mind, we can go to the first slide. Thank you. On this one, well, I'm going to read what's on the right-hand side of the slide. That this is calendar A, first of all, and teachers start on August 19th. So you can see the pink circle there. And teachers end on June 6th, which is the yellow. Well, in June 6th, there's a... exempt fundraiser day. And then students start on August 26th because they can only start until the fourth Monday of the month of August. So August 5th is the first Monday, August 12th is the second one, August 19th is the third, and then August 26th is the fourth. So by law, we have to start until then. So that's why we start on August 26th. And then the students, their last day would be June 6th, which equals to 180 school days. So it doesn't give us a lot of room, but let me just quickly go through the first one. On August 19th through the 22nd, those are staff development days. Usually teachers like those at the beginning. They get, you know, get motivated. They get started on, you know, looking at all the curriculum, the instruction, a lot of that, and all new policies, any new discipline policies, attendance policies, everything. And then on the 23rd, it is a work day for the teachers. So if you notice in September, there's nothing. So they start working right through October 14th. That's a staff development day. And then in November, there's always that Thanksgiving week that most of us cherish a lot. And then in December, you have 2 weeks off, December 23rd all the way to January 3rd. And then the teachers come back on January 6th as a staff development day. And then in February, we have a non-school day in February 10th. And then in March, we have spring break, which we just came from spring break, and we all are relaxed. If you can see the whole audience, they're all relaxed. March 17th through the 21st. And then in April, we will have Good Friday off, which is the 18th. And then in May 26th, there's also a law there. May 26th, it prohibits schools from offering instruction on Memorial Day. So that's House Bill 44-1. So May 26th, it's a must. We can't have school. So that's why, that's your, I'm gonna say, this is calendar A. We had the teachers vote on it. If you go to the next slide, this is calendar B. The only difference here is October 14th is not a staff development day anymore. It's a non-school day. So where did this staff development day go to? If you look now at August 16th, we converted it into a work day for the teachers. So in other words, and I forgot to mention, the green, the darker green, that's enrichment days. So when we start next year, enrichment days will start on July 29th, goes through August the 16th, but on that same day, it's going to be a work day for the teachers. So now they'll have a work day on the 16th. 19th through the 22nd will be staff development days. The 23rd is a work day. Okay, and then in October now, instead of a staff day, it'll be a non-school day. So that's the only difference from calendar A to calendar B. Another thing I want to point out is, again, all of these calendars have 180 days. Teachers work 187 days. So where are these 7 days? Well, it's actually all the staff development days and the work days. Okay, let's go to calendar C. Now, calendar C, we wanted to make it a little bit different. And if you look at November, so I'm going to ask you to look at November, the November 25th and November 26th. So those 2 days, the students would come to school. So where are those now? Okay, so then, because we hear that teachers or faculty and staff say, well, we want like something every month. Okay, we can give you something like that. However, Thanksgiving will be shorter. So the first day is in September 30th. So that's a staff development day. So that's one of those days in November. The other day is in April 21st, which is the Monday after Easter. So that's what calendar C is. So we put these three calendars out. If you go to the next slide. These are the numbers, how everyone voted. And for calendar A, we had a total of 594 faculty and staff members vote for it. And you can see there in the bar graph, it tells you the different, I'm gonna say categories, like for teachers is the green, the maroon is paraprofessionals, the blue is the clerks, the principals are the yellow, and then others, okay? And then the calendar B, which is in the middle section, we had 1,183 vote for this calendar, which is calendar B. And then the last calendar was C, which is 223. Now, you might want to know, well, what was the percentage? Well, we do have about 4,000 employees, a little bit over 4,000, but usually we don't tell, well, we have the maintenance department and the ones that have those type of calendars that work almost the entire year, and it doesn't matter what calendar wins, they still need to work. So they don't vote, but all the others did vote. So that brings us down to about 3,000. So out of the 3,000, if you add the votes for all three calendars, there were 2,000 people that voted. So you have about 1,000 that did not vote. But, I mean, it was their decision. However, from the 3,000, that means 67% of the population voted for it. Now, how many voted for calendar B? Well, out of the 2,000, or the ones that all voted, 60% voted for calendar B. So in other words, calendar B would win. So that is our recommendation, that you approve calendar B. If you want to go to the next slide. That one. So that's what we're recommending, that you approve the votes. I don't know if you have any questions.
That's about as similar as you can get to what we had last year?
Yes, sir. It's very similar because The law, like I said, says in August we have to start until the fourth Monday.
Or this year, actually.
Yes, for this year. For next year would be the same as this year's. We're finishing this year June 7th. Next year would be June 6th. So it's very, very similar.
Any comments by any of the board members?
I do. I know okay. that the teachers like coming in that second week after New Year's. Because 1 year they came in on January the 2nd.
Yes.
And we heard so many complaints about that one. So I see that it's January 6th. I know that, maybe that was part of the B also.
Because the only criticism would be for this one is that you didn't give me enough time to shop for Christmas. Okay. So.
I feel like Trustee said, and I think I'd rather come in a little bit later after okay. Christmas than yeah. or the New Year's.
I agree.
Okay.
Yeah.
Jesse?
Hey, that's what they voted. The staff has spoken.
That's it.
If you go against that, boy, it's over 60% of the staff voted for calendar B.
Calendar B.
It's hard to justify making any
So we need a motion.
Changes.
Right?
Yeah, yes.
Was there a motion? No, there was a motion.
You want to make a motion, Jess?
I move that we approve the calendar.
Okay, motion made by Mr. Vetta. Second by?
Second.
Second by Mrs. Sedna. All those in favor, raise your right hand. Motion carries. Thank you, Mr. Roy. Excellent presentation on the numbers. Dr. Elias, we don't have anything else?
Yes, Mr. President. We have under student services also, Dr. Nayola will be presenting discussion of district-wide intruder detection yes. audit yes, report sir. Findings.
Yana Serna and I are going to be excused. We've heard it four times. So.
Okay.
No, go ahead, sir.
I guess before I start the slides, I just want to say that every day that is our top priority in PSJA is to have all students, all faculty and staff members that they feel safe and secure. That's what we're doing, and we're working very closely, of course, with Chief Garcia, who's in charge of all the policemen, and Dr. Borrego, who's in charge of all security guards. So we all have trained all our campuses at the beginning of the school year, and we keep on training them to make sure that all of our faculty and staff are trained on the safety measures that the state imposes or says that we're supposed to follow. We appreciate, of course, all your support. Thank you, Mr. Villegas, Ms. Serna, that you're always there for our meetings. And so thank you for your support. Also, Dr. Elias. And I just want to mention that Dr. Elias started a new initiative that, you know, yes, the state tells us what they want us to do. But then Dr. Elias said, you know what? Let's go ahead and do another layer of security. So we have our securities, our supervisors now going out to the campuses to conduct in-house safety audits. So that's within our own district. We've seen some very good results. So I just want to let the board know that that was an initiative that Dr. Elias wanted us to do. We're doing it, and it's really coming out very profitable for us. Now, I just want to also say that throughout the school year, of course, the intruder comes in to the campuses. These audits, of course, are to test how if they can step into our grounds, you know, undetected. And, of course, we catch them all the time, which is excellent. And these audits also help our district to identify how we can improve our safety for the students and staff. So if we go to the next slide or the first slide, this is what they do when they come in, the intruder. They want to check that all the gates are locked. That's intruder access. They also want to check that all exterior doors are locked and they're in good conditions, which is exterior door audit. And then number three, they're checking that all classroom doors are closed and locked. That's why it says classroom doors. And then they also checked, are we doing weekly sweeps? The custodian, they have a committee. Each campus has a committee. They go on a weekly basis out there to make sure that everything is in working order. The fences, the gates, the exterior doors. So all of that is in order. If you go to the next slide. Now, if they find something, the intruder, then these are the corrective action steps we would have to do. An in-person training on intruder access, an in-person training on exterior door audit, and in-person training on classroom doors. So Mr. Garcia and myself, we go to the campuses, we tell them, you know, we go through the whole training, we tell them about all of these things have to be locked and closed. And then what we do, we present to the District Safety and Security Committee, which Mr. Villegas, Ms. Serna are part of it. And then we bring it to you, the board. And, you know, we understand that parents and community members sometimes want to know all the details and they want to know what schools, but, you know, it is in the best interest of the students that we do not share this information, as it could lead to compromising important campus security information. But we would like to assure the parents and community members that PSJA is committed to providing a safe and secure learning environment for our students and staff. And so with that, I just want to say thank you, board members, for your support, Dr. Elias, for new initiatives, and thank you for everything that you do for us, for the safety of our students and our staff.
Thank you, Dr. Noyola. I think it's going to go a long way. Dr. Elias is, again, that initiative Dr. Noyola was mentioning on having checkups, if you will, with our own staff. So I just want to impress that where we, because we're doing other things that are going to include enhancing our windows, our doors, our locks, and all of that, which is good. That's up to us.
Yes.
But at the campus, the leaders need to make sure that one thing that we don't want to have is unlocked doors.
Exactly.
So if we can do that, we can prevent a lot of issues.
Exactly. Thank you.
Mr. Vela, thank you for showing up, sir. I know it's difficult at times, but we are so, so happy that you joined us today. And get some rest, and we'll be in touch.
And thank you to Adi as well. Thank you to
his
son, Adi, as well.
And to Adi as well. You guys are amazing. Thank you, Jesse. Oh, hold on, Jesse. To adjourn?
Oh, no, we still have.
We have to.
We have some more business?
Adjustment.
It's a report only.
No, we
it's just like a presentation.
Oh, it's just a. But can we hear it?
Adjourn the meeting, and then we're in a very public committee meeting.
Okay.
Adjourn the meeting.
Okay. The legal counsel has advised. I have entertained a motion to adjourn. We're adjourning?
Yes.
We don't have to make a motion for adjourn? We are adjourned. Okay.
You don't have a quorum.
All right. That's
the
right.
Time of adjournment.
Okay. Now?
Yes. So you're adjourned at 8:23.
So now, Mr. President, the presentation right now will be on the investment report for quarter ending November 30th, 2023.
Okay. And I want to apologize for Trustee Vela. He's under some strenuous circumstances, and sometimes he needs to get home. But we're here to listen to your presentation and then have at it.
Yes, sir. Well, I'm honored to be here, honored to be partners with you guys as far as doing your investment advisory. Dr. Elias and other members of the board here. My name is David McElwain. I'm a Director of Advisory Services for Meter Public Funds. And we've been working proactively with your finance staff and developing an investment strategy going forward. We think it's very important. You know, this is our first quarterly report, and I was hoping to be here standing in front of you to present it. So we'll quickly walk through this because, as everyone in the room knows, the Federal Reserve just went through the most aggressive rate hike in modern history. They raised the Fed funds rate almost 5.25% in just over a year and a half, barely over a year and a half. And prior to that, obviously with COVID, we had almost a 0% interest rate. So we went from zero to almost 60 in the shortest period ever, which has been great. You've seen your interest income go up more than tenfold over the past couple of years. But 2 years ago, inflationary rates went up to 9%, which got the Fed thinking, we need to cool this down. And as we came through the end of November, it was still questionable as to whether the Fed was done raising rates. We now know the Fed is done raising rates. At the end of November, they paused for the second consecutive time. They just wrapped up their meeting last week. They've now paused five consecutive times, but their language has indicated that on a consensus basis, the game plan is they will cut rates three times before the end of this year, which will be 0.75% roughly. And then next year in 25, they would expect to go another three, possibly four more times. So we've seen, you know, unfortunately, our cash rates are going to start to decline. So we think it's very important right now to kind of think about where the ball is going, not where it's been. We think it's a great time to start positioning money a little bit further out and developing a portfolio strategy. And as we see here, the Fed's, you know, watching these CPI and CPE data, it's not quite where they want it to be. They'd like to see inflation get down to 2%. The thing that's sticky right now is the core PCI and PCE, and that's generally a large basket of goods that everybody's got to pay for on a consistent basis. That number's still in the low 3% range, and I think we'll probably see them go in sometime around summertime with the first cut. But the thing that we have seen for 20 consecutive months now is we've been an inverted yield curve, and that's contrary to what a normal yield curve looks like. Normally, the yield curve is positively sloping. So to the extent that you have funds that you can invest further out, you would expect to get more yield as you go from 2 years from 1 year, and to go from 2 years to 3 years, you'd get more yield. Right now, it's just the opposite. And that's just simply because when the Fed starts to cut on the short end, you'll see the yield curve flatten out. And as they, you know, continue to cut, we'll see that yield curve get a more normal shape to it. So the yield curve right there, as of the end of November of 22, the Fed wasn't done. You see how it peaked out in the yellow line, and it was lower. And then we got, you know, to October. Rates got to about the highest point in September, October. And then they started to decline in November in anticipation that they were talking about cutting rates in 24. But the portfolio itself, quarter over quarter, we ended August with just over $136 million in book value and market value. And as we closed out November, the portfolio was $148.9 million. You can see the change in market value was a little over $12.5 million. The average yield to maturity for the portfolio was slightly above 5%. And obviously, it's been chasing the Federal Reserve's aggressive rate moves. But to look at the portfolio just a little bit more in detail, the majority of the portfolio is in cash or overnight instruments, local government investment pools. You've got 93% or $138.9 million completely liquid in overnight securities, which has been great because it's allowed you to, you know, closely capture those aggressive Fed rate hikes. There was just $10 million in a Texas term product that was purchased, fortunately, in September when rates were near their peaks. And that'll remain on the books for six more months, and it'll mature out in September. And that's at a rate of just below 6%. As you can see, the pie slice there, you're diversified in a number of pools there, Tex Pool Prime being the largest percentage of the pools, followed by Texas Range and Lone Star. And then you've got some in 16% in Texas Fit with 4% in bank deposits. Again, this is just another like depiction of the portfolio spelling out by book value and market value with the average yields of the respective pools there, Tex Pool Prime being on top. But this is the format that, you know, you'll expect when you see a quarterly report. As of the end of November itself, the average yield was a 5.12. That aforementioned yield of just below 5.10 was the average yield for the quarter. And then you can see that the bottom box shows you what the yield or the earnings were for the November time frame. And fiscal year to date, since you closed out in August, you've got almost $1.5 million in interest earnings. The rest of the report will just break down the various fund groups of the portfolio. And I'll just open it up right now. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on the more granular details, but if y'all have any questions specific to the portfolio or specific to the economic outlook, feel free to fire away.
I have a question. So how often do you all communicate so that we can have some kind of recommendation as what direction we need to take. Especially because, you know, what he was talking about, because keeping up with the fact that we've got interest rates going up for quite a period of time, and now we are going to start seeing a decline in the interest rates. So
we've been calling him more frequently. Yes.
Okay.
It was easy when the interest rates were going up, it was easy for us to do our own investing.
You didn't want to call him, you know, to leave him alone.
Right. And now that we're seeing them go down, we're really leaning more on the meter group to help us with a strategy to maximize our earnings now before they fall too low.
Okay. Thank you. I just wanted to make sure we had that line open so we knew exactly where to put our monies and stuff like that. Dr. Elias, do you have anything or any of the other board members?
I'm just happy we're doing good.
Yes, we are. Well, $1.5 million almost in interest, right?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. And like I said, rates have peaked. So you're starting to see the pool rates come down, you know, little by little. And that's just because the highest rates have already been achieved. The reinvestment rates now. For discount commercial paper, short-term, nine-month investment back in September would have been around 580, 585. That same nine-month term in a commercial paper program that meets the PFIA requirements is on a good day about a 540, 538, somewhere in that neighborhood. So the reinvestment rates are coming down. Where you're going to see the rates really start to go down aggressively is when the Fed seesaws and starts to make these 0.25 rate cuts.
And I know Ms. Gonzalez and I have been talking about that, so we're really looking at if we are reinvest to look at a longer term, that way we stay with the higher interest rate, so that way it kind of shelters us from going to those low rates.
Yes, sir, that's correct.
Do we have a window before we can't do that anymore, or do we still have some time to start looking at this aggressively?
Yeah, well, I think the million-dollar question is, when are they going to go for the first time? And like I said, you know, initially the market thought maybe they would go as early as March, and clearly that's not going to be the case. But we would think, I mean, we've been pre-planning for this eventuality, right? We know rates are going to go down. It's just a question of when. Yeah. So right now, like I said, it's kind of paramount for us. We've been having the discussion.
Well, come down as often as you need to, sir, but we do need to, Becky, stay on top of it, and I'm sure Dr. Elias will.
I know I follow Powell a lot on the interest rates and all that, so I'm very, very aware of all that.
He's very good at that.
Yes, sir. Well, we're here to try to push you in the right direction to the extent that we can figure out, you know, how much of the funds can be pushed out, you know, how far it's appropriate. And we'll also construct a very short-term liquid portfolio for the short-term operating needs, naturally.
Very good.
Okay.
Well, we appreciate you being here tonight. Thank you for your presentation. It had a lot of clarity in it. Anything? No? Thank you, sir.
Thank you all. Very much appreciate it.
So with that, we're already finished with our meeting. Ben?
Yes, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Are we already adjourned?